this, maybe I'm blind, thinking I can see through this and see what's behind. Got no way to prove it, so maybe I'm lying. But I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. Take a look in the mirror, what do you see? Do you see it clearer, or are you deceived in what you believe? 'Cause I'm only human after all, and you're only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put the blame on me. I'm only human, I do what I can. I'm just a man, I do what I can. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put your blame on me.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, respected Deputy Vice-Chancellors, respected Deans, senior academics, staff, students, friends, colleagues. We'd like to welcome you to the launch of the Humanising Pedagogy portal and poster. My name is Mukhtar Aban, and I'm going to hand over immediately, because of the food that we can smell, I'm going to hand over to our Deputy Vice-Chancellor, Professor Denise. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Molweni, goeiemiddag, to everybody here. It is such a great pleasure for me to be part of this launching of the portal, and I think we need to give the people who produced this another round of applause. They thought about it very carefully, as you can see. Every word, every image has meaning. And you will see that some of the characters in the little film, they stand in contemplation. And it is because part of the humanizing pedagogy and the orientation that we want to promote and adopt and advance at our institution, at Mandela University, is one of reflection, is one of contemplation, of thinking deeply, of thinking critically, and of questioning the kinds of things that make us human, the kind of world we live in, and how inhabiting this world helps us to take care of it. So in launching this, I want to give you a little bit of background to where all of this has come from. Professor Raj Naidu, sitting there, former Dean of Health Sciences, said to me when he first came, or when I first came, he was already here, that he remembers this word or this term, humanizing pedagogy, being dropped. And now suddenly, here it is, and it's part of, I think, everything that we do and everything that we aspire to doing at Nelson Mandela University. It's a very significant time to be launching this portal. It is the year of the centenary of Nelson Mandela's birth, of his being part of our nation and being the inspirational leader, world leader that he has been. It comes at a time just after we have launched the name of our university, which is now fully Nelson Mandela University, not just the university that belongs to the city or the metropole, but is here in the name of this iconic human being. It's significant because we launched the centenary program in July this year, on the anniversary of his birth. And so I think, coincidentally, because the team have been working on this for a very long time, the launch of this portal happens in this year. They've been working on it, and we've been working on it for probably about two, three years now. And the whole idea and the notion of the humanizing pedagogy, of course, got incorporated into the vision of Nelson Mandela University in around 2009, 2010, as part of our vision for what this university could be. It became adopted within that vision as part of our teaching and learning philosophy, or our philosophy of how learning happens and should happen and should be taught and should be researched and engaged and administered in this university that carries this name. Now, it's almost 10 years later, we have a new Vice-Chancellor, Professor Sibongile Mutwa, and in all of her work, in an inaugural address, we see her again calling on and drawing on the notion of a humanizing pedagogy into putting us as Nelson Mandela University on the map. So it has this real deep association with who we want to be. And so it is a very significant moment for us that this portal, which enables us and gives us a space to engage with each other, that this gets launched today. So it started quite a long time ago. For me personally, this is really important because I studied in a place where a humanizing pedagogy came back into fashion, as it were, through the work of people like Donaldo Macedo, who invited Paulo Freire to the university that I was studying at the time. And we re-examined his work and got engaged with him around this whole notion of a humanizing pedagogy. But of course, if our former VC, Derek Swartz, was here, he was saying, it was long before that. We used to sit under the trees at UWC with our banned copies of Pedagogy of the Oppressed, and we used to read all of this stuff. So yes, it goes quite a long way back that we've adopted this particular notion of a humanizing pedagogy. It's not a new notion. And many humanists will talk about the fact that humanism and education have always been integrally linked. But the particular notion of a humanizing pedagogy that we have adopted at this institution and at some others as well has been one that has taken on the notion of social justice as an intrinsic, integral part of becoming human and being human and adopting a humanizing stance. Because we cannot become our full human selves if we are not also conscious of the ways in which people have been dehumanized and the ways in which we have an absolute human duty to engage with that inequality, to engage with social injustice, and to say for people to become fully human, we have to look at ways in which we address the social injustice. So it's very integrally linked. And as Andre Kiert, you all know Professor Andre Kiert, or you should know him, or you'll get to know him, who is now part of our institution under holding the chair in critical studies and higher education transformation. He and I have worked a lot on this from our time at Fort Hare, where we have said it's not a soft option. A humanizing pedagogy is a very hard option. It's not only about being nice to each other, even though we do expect that as human beings. It is not only about respecting each other, which of course we have to do as human beings. It's also taking up the fight against that which dehumanizes. And so as we think about it as a pedagogy, as something that teaches, a pedagogy is really anything that teaches. It doesn't only happen in the classroom. It happens in the way we are with each other, our ways of being. It happens in how we do things, our ways of doing. It happens certainly in how we think and our ways of thinking. And it has to include questioning what is not right. It has to include questioning what our obligation is as human beings to doing what is right for the benefit of all, including our planet. So in 2010, it got adopted into the vision of Nelson Mandela University. It was then NMMU. I can't even say it anymore. That's great. It got adopted in 2010. Heather's not here, Heather now, but she was part of pulling that vision together from input from and discussions from across the university, and has now become an intrinsic part of how we think about what we ought to be doing, Are we doing it yet? Our students and some of our staff will say, no, we're not doing it yet. But it is what we want to do. It is what we're working to do. And we always are in the process of becoming. So in 2011, we started a hub. I was then in the Faculty of Education as the Dean of the Faculty of Education. We started a hub, a humanizing pedagogy hub, where we started experimenting with what does this idea mean to people? And we started looking at people's own experiences of having had a humanizing pedagogy. And out of that, we developed, out of people's stories, their own stories. In a sense, we were decolonizing even that at that time, because we said, what are your own experiences of that? And we came up with a whole range of different aspects of what it means to experience a humanizing pedagogy. And out of these, we published an article out of that, and out of these, we got seeds of what are the kinds of things we could be doing in classrooms, in research, in our ordinary engagements in, with society and in society. We also then published a whole series of articles started getting published as faculties started taking up the idea of a humanizing pedagogy and what it means in praxis. For those of you who haven't come across the term praxis, because they say, you know, the social scientists use these terms that the scientists don't really know all that well. But the praxis is how does that theory then become incorporated into your action. So when we talk about praxis, we're looking at understanding why we are doing things and then also putting it into practice. So there have been a number of different engagements around what this praxis is. And we've had a number of articles published, many of them from people within the Faculty of Education. We're also hoping that we'll have many of them being published in across all the faculties, across the sciences, across the engineering. In fact, we do have an engineer, someone working with engineering, Dr. Munir, who started looking at what are some of the soft skills that have to be introduced amongst people who are thinking of projects and thinking of planning and thinking of construction. She's in fact presenting on that in the conference called Being Human today. So from the 2011 hub, we then established a research niche area. We have our DVC research and engagement here. Prof Leach, thank you for being here. And it was one of the, I think, 11 or 13 research niche areas that we had in the institution at the time. And a number of research projects were then funded as part of that research niche. And then it went into decline, mainly because there are always people behind projects. There are always people driving these kinds of things. And we experimented for a while when I moved into the DVC teaching and learning about who would take over driving this niche. Andre was still at UFS at the time, and we couldn't co-opt him fully into that kind of position. We worked with students, hoping they would be able to drive it, but of course, they had other things that they had to do. And then along came Mukhtar. And I asked him if he would be interested in taking over the sort of driving role for humanizing pedagogy. And he did, and he analyzed what we had, and he said, but if you're going to do anything, where's it going to go? He said, you don't have a teaching and learning site, website at Nelson Mandela University. And I said, that is true. And he said, well, we're going to develop one. And that then became the first project under Mukhtar's leadership. And the way he went about it was humanizing. The first thing he said was, so where do the skill sets lie? We have got to set this up for us. And he immediately said, our students actually have these skill sets. And he assembled a team of people who are graduates or students in the Faculty of Arts in Media and Communication. And some of them not. Some of them were in engineering, actually. We've got one in engineering here. Some of them were in other places. And this team set up the teaching and learning website, which then became the home. And within this home now, we have the humanizing pedagogy portal, which is being launched today. So I want to acknowledge here, as we sit here, the names of the current team work with Mukhtar. There was a previous team. I can't remember all their names now, but they were from all over. Some of them are still here. So I just want them to stand up. Actually, some of them are already standing, and to acknowledge them. Clayton, who is behind the camera at the back there. And Clayton, some of you have come to know. He was part of the team last year, self-taught, and is an inspiration to us on what human beings can achieve. So thank you, Clayton. Then some new people on the block. Nadia. Where is Nadia? Nadia, who is part of the team this year, comes with a media qualification that she got at Pretoria University, and we're so glad that she got married and came to Port Elizabeth, because she's now part of our team. And then we have Laik. Where is Laik? There he is, standing behind that camera. I'm not quite sure what Laik does when he's not doing this. He's a graduate of our university from media. Yes, so there we go. We're showing off what we can do. And then Wayne, who is actually in engineering. And he's also a part of this team. And, of course, Mukhtar. Please stand, Mukhtar. No, you understand? So this is Mukhtar, who is our leader. He's our leader. So I just wanted to introduce all of those to you. Before we go on, I just want to say that what you are going to see will be an overview of the portal. We hope that you will visit it often and look at how you can engage through the portal, because unlike people like myself who have absolute clumsiness around technology, we have a generation who are very adept at working with technology, and what we have found is a very great intergenerational engagement, which I hope is how we could always do things, an intergenerational engagement around what is the work that needs to be done. And I'll say a little bit about this when we close off, but for now I want to hand over to Mukhtar to take us through this this portal.
Thank you, Professor Zinn. I just want to provide an overview of the HPPRN project, the Humanising Pedagogy, Praxis and Research Niche project that is in the teaching and learning portfolio. So the aims of this project include to document, promote and coordinate HP activities, practices and research at Nelson Mandela University. Primarily a coordination and documentation initiative. We developed a proposal, a plan of what we'd like to do as part of the HPPRN, and this launch and this portal is only but one step or one aspect of that plan, and all of these details will be available, in fact are available, on the portal already. I'd like to just give you a video overview, and then I'll give you an explanation of what you can find on the portal. Thank you to the media team for putting all these animations together for us. Thank you. So the HP portal is housed on the university's Moodle site. It can be accessed directly using the link available there. Please don't attempt yet. We'll first have lunch and then I'll officially open the portal to everyone. Okay? Food before pleasure, eh? So the portal provides you with an overview of humanizing pedagogy. Many have said that we've seen this in policy documents, we've heard academics speaking about it, but need to be sort of familiarized with the concept as a whole, so you'll find that there on the portal. We then give you literature and resources that speak to a humanizing pedagogy. We thought to humanize the process. We interview authors of those articles to give us that added human element to understanding the literature. And so you'll find our featured article at the moment is Mutual Vulnerability, and the author interviewed there is Professor Andre Kiert. And you'll get a very wonderful synopsis of the concept prior to entering into the literature. We also find academics exploring humanizing pedagogy in practice and praxis, and so we interview them as well and get their, sort of take on the approach, and that's all for at your disposal to inform how you conceptualize it, how you understand it, and so forth. Our student voices are, it's an important feature of the portal. We've interviewed various students and we've engaged them on how do they understand a humanizing pedagogy. And I think it's a critical video on our portal because it gives university staff as a whole, academic, past, professional, administrative, it gives the staff an idea of how do students understand this idea of a humanizing pedagogy. There are discussion forums, engagement features, and we have sign-up forms. So as you are engaging, you'll find that there are features in which we ask you to give us your immediate feedback. After you've watched a clip, what ideas come forth, what is sparked, we'd like to capture that. And then there are sign-up forms if you want to form part of communities of practice that are specific to your faculty, to particular groupings within the university. And also if you'd like to form part officially of the research hub, there's a sign-up form there as well. And if you are interested in or engaging with the humanizing pedagogy in any way, there's an innovation alert form that would basically, as the title says, it will alert us to your innovation. And then, of course, that information is sent to the teaching and learning portfolio, and the media team will also possibly contact you for an interview or to write an article and so forth. On the side, you'll see what it looks like. Different features are available, and ultimately, we require the university community to engage with the resources so that it gives us a better idea of where to take the project, and also those forming part of the research hub, once they have ethics clearance to access the data from the portal, will be able to engage with what is available there. At the moment, all the data on this portal is primarily being sought and generated to create a greater hype around humanizing pedagogy, to infuse understanding and various approaches to humanizing pedagogy in the different spaces. I must highlight as well that the HP portal has created specific spaces for past staff, because often we find that past staff are not engaging sufficiently with a concept that is sort of part of our being at Nelson Mandela University. So we urge everyone to engage as much as possible. And that takes us on to our next initiative, and it forms part, actually, of the portal indirectly, and that is our poster project. So the Humanizing Pedagogy Praxis and Research niche felt that it would be appropriate to have a physical artifact available in spaces of the university, a poster of sort, to remind academics, students, everyone, of different aspects of a humanizing pedagogy. And we thought that the best way would be to extract elements from literature. Just one or two words, or a sentence or two, or bullet points and so forth, and to put it in a visual form, to serve as a reminder, but also to generate additional ideas. So I, in my own capacity, experimented. Of course, I've seen the poster, naturally. And I've put the poster up, and when you are engaging with a student or a colleague and you revisit your office and that poster is there and you read one word, additional thoughts do come about. And so that is the idea with this poster, to have something available as a reminder of the teaching and learning philosophy of the university. And so we are going to call on Professor Denise to unveil our poster shortly. Let me just give you an overview of key aspects that can be found in the poster. So you're going to see some concepts now, and when you receive your poster, that's part of the deal of coming here. I know many of you came here actually for the poster, not the food. Please reflect on the terms you're about to see and try and find them on the poster. Denise to unveil the poster. Of course, we had to call on the expert services of a graphic designer to help us conceptualize this poster. You have academics on the one hand, but you need the, you know, graphic designers and those who are driven and passionate about, you know, what we see visually to assist us. And we'd like to acknowledge Miss Almeen Waring for her contribution. Please come to the front. Almeen has been very patient in dealing with academics, and we are very grateful for that. I'll call upon Professor Zinn to give us the way forward now. Thank you.
Thank you. So you can see why I'm sitting with such a smile on my face. It's like I can't get the smile off my face because they've done such a fantastic job, this team. Mukhtar and they've done all of it. There's been a little bit of consultation with me here and there about things, but they sat and they worked so hard on every single aspect of this. So well done to the team. Let's give them a round of applause. So just going forward then, a couple of things that I want to invite you to participate in. The first is that I notice even on the conference that is happening today in this really spiffy little program, which is really lovely. I'm sure it was also done by our students. Eh, Jackie? So this being human or humane in the 21st century, this is a conference that's going on at the moment, and I'm thinking that that's probably the reason why this room isn't full. Because people like Khatija were just busy presenting or teaching. But you will see as you go through this that there are actually quite a number of presentations that actually intersect with the theme of a humanizing pedagogy. And I know Andre will be the first person to say, I hope there's going to be a book that comes out of it. So we do hope that there will be publications that come out of the work that people do when they present at conferences, because this stream actually runs all the way through the work that we do at Nelson Mandela University. And if it doesn't, then we've got to ask the question, why not? because in everything that we do, we think this has to be part of it. So conferences, papers, and then there are huge transformation projects underway at the moment at our institution and in the higher education sector, in society in general, but with this being our location. And I think a lot of those projects are the transformation projects are there because we have acknowledged the importance of addressing some of the inequities and inequalities that exist in the higher education environment. And these go all the way from how we engage with each other, relationships in classrooms, how we set up a curriculum, whether that curriculum actually engages with the social issues of our day and how we need to address them, with the decolonization project, with issues of relevance, with education for liberation, and all of these concepts are integrally linked with the humanizing pedagogy. So as you engage in these, and your colleagues and your fellow students engage in these projects within your faculties, think about how you would describe it, how you would write it up, how you would interrogate it. In other words, what is the nature of the research that you could do that could help deepen both your own understandings, but also for others, this notion of how a humanizing pedagogy can actually start making an impact on improving education in this country and in the world. So I'm encouraging and asking you to do that. In order to find a space for that work, we now have our portal where you can engage, but also we will be starting to drive and resuscitate the work of the humanizing pedagogy research theme. We had to work hard, Prof. Leach put us through our paces to justify why we needed to have a humanizing pedagogy theme, because if we're going to have this as a research theme at the institution, there better be work that underlies that. There better be enough research that makes it justifiable. And so it's an encouragement when we do have our first meeting this year to resuscitate the humanizing pedagogy research theme, that many of you will come and attend, even if you don't yet have that as part of your agenda. I see many of you sitting in the room, from Shireen at the back there, that I know did a master's that had a humanizing research component to it. To many of you sitting here, I see that thread running through your work. I see many of you engaging in faculties, right, Tobeka, on what a humanizing pedagogy means and how that becomes part of the curriculum. All of these experiments need to be written up. Jackie, Chantal, people who are engaged in language transformation work and policy development, that all needs to be written up, and I know that there's a thread that links to a humanizing pedagogy through that. The work of Khatija Adams sitting in front, you'll see a lot of it on the portal because she incorporates it with innovation into everything that she does as well. So I'm looking forward to having many of you, first of all, attend the research theme convening that will happen early in September, and also see you then starting to develop proposals, to developing scholarship of teaching and learning proposals, as well as looking at how you can start documenting the work that we have done. Some of that documentation you will find on the portal that documents the work that has been done over the past couple of years. So colleagues, I think that's all I want to say, to invite you to really fully participate in this novel way, an innovative way that the media team have set up to make it exciting, enticing, and that we will see lots more coming out, even after you've retired, some of you who are sitting here and are anticipating that prospect, including myself, right, Mary Duker and Prof. Waite and Prof. Raj, there's still place for us. There will still be place for us to do this work. A thank you to Cheryl Foxcroft, who is in our Centre for Teaching and Learning, and some of the colleagues who are here, who are in support of this work and the ways in which it then comes into the support work for faculties as well.